Braves owner, media mogul Ted Turner wanted a comprehensive television special about his major league team. With Turner's pledge of full access and with the full resources of WTBS, the documentary would use the Braves to tell the story of a year in the life of a typical Major League Baseball team, offering a deep look at some of the usually hidden aspects of big league life. "I think we ought to have a special on the Braves," Turner said. "We own the team. We can have full access. What do you guys think?" "One of the first things I said is, 'What is my budget?'" asked Turner Sports executive Terry Hanson. And Ted says, "Well, whatever it takes." So we never felt we had to cut corners. Producer Glenn Diamond led a crew that recorded over 400 hours of footage. First-year Braves manager Joe Torre agreed to be mic'd up for about 50 games during the 1982 season. The crew recorded players goofing around in the clubhouse. It shadowed players on road trips and got to attend and film a private team awards banquet in Montreal.
The following is a TBS Sports special presentation. It's a long way to October, brought to you by Cable News Network, America's most important network, and by CNN Headline News, America's headline service. Now you have a choice in 24-hour television news from Turner Broadcasting System. If you don't have CNN and CNN Headline News, contact your cable operator today.
Fly ball, short center. Washington is tagging. Let's watch. He dropped the ball. Horner going toward second. Safe, and a run score.
We can't do nothing wrong.
How can he drop it?
We got to win the pennant. You know that?
Well, anybody can be a prophet this early in the season. That's baseball. The grand old game. America's pastime. It's a game so simple that four-year-olds play it every day. And yet it's so complex and deceptive that sometimes 50-year-olds can't figure it out. I know I've been around big league teams some 50 years, winning clubs, second division teams. And there are times that I can't understand this thing called baseball. Well, we're going to try and tell you the story of a year in the life of a baseball team. How are we going to do it? Especially a team as typical and yet as strikingly different as any team that ever played. Where do we begin?
Hey, Red, why don't you begin where we began, in spring training?
17. Here, run in place and get your knees up high. There we go. Come on. Knees up high. Break that down on your back.
Right there.
And stretch it. Touch it with the right hand. Left, up.
Push it. Push it. 7, 8.
Okay, down on your back again.
Okay, that's the right.
This could be anywhere, from Vero Beach to Yuma, from Fort Myers to Sun City. It is instead West Palm Beach, where the Atlanta Braves have shared dreams for decades. They arrive in varying shades of winter pale, the nightmares of seasons past now dim in their minds, the hopes of a fresh start charging their batteries.
I just want to welcome everybody to spring training with the Atlanta Braves. As far as I'm concerned, and I think you'll all agree with me, is that we're here to win the pennant. I think we're cheating you, cheating me, cheating the fans, unless we're here other than to do that. There's only one place to finish, and that's first. And the only thing that makes the club win the pennant as opposed to the ones that don't is the desire and the concentration and the preparation. There's nothing fancy about winning. It just takes hard work. You're all here to do a job. It's our system. We'll tell you how we want you to work out. So when we start the games, my plan is to make sure that everybody gets a look-see. And the only guys that probably won't get as much playing time in as I would like are the catchers, and that's because we have eight catchers and only so many guys that can play. So I was a catcher in the past, and I got dumped on, so those are the guys that are just going to have to take the brunt of it. Anybody have any questions? Okay, let's go. Let's start. Yes, sir. Ball jump off the bat right there, Larry.
The Braves find themselves hearing new voices behind the batting cage, seeing new faces examining their abilities. Joe Torre, who was one of them a decade ago, is now their new manager. With him, a completely new staff. But despite all of this, some things never change.
I'll never forget when I was playing, I never showed up before the game started. I always hold out.
You and Burroughs.
I just never liked it. I knew I was in shape. That's why it didn't bother me. I just did not want early exhibition games when you're facing these phenoms who are trying to get Joe Torre out.
As long as I'm moving towards the ball.
As long as you're moving to the ball, it's fine.
It's like that's the difference between you and him. You were moving more, but he wasn't moving at all.
See, all that's going to do is give you more movement. Now, the more movement you got, the more for error, right?
Right.
Okay. The less movement, the less movement.
The simpler.
Exactly.
Less things can go wrong. With
exactly. Okay. Exactly. So if you, when you first learned how to walk, you fell on your ass many times. Many, right?
I guess.
Okay. Until you learned how to walk.
Now, let's do this.
Exactly the same spot. You got to shorten up a little bit more to get that ball to really snap down.
Okay.
It's nothing to think about a lot, but you know, just kind of keep that in mind. Okay. Especially when you throw a curveball and it starts hanging up here. 99 times out of 100 is because you took too long of a stride. Yeah.
Okay.
And when you have a lot of problems with it up there, then just try to shorten up a little bit. Just a little, not a lot, but just a little bit.
Okay.
And you'll be surprised.
Catch it up here, swipe. Like this, like that. It's over here, like that. Always a swiping motion, going away from the runner. So that he helps you kind of, he tags himself and then kicks your glove out of the way. And if you're like that, he's going to break your wrist, your finger, knock the ball out of your glove. He's going to make things bad for us. So don't do it, okay? All right.
It is important to manager Joe Torre's Braves to develop in this camp more than strong arms and quick wrists. The head controls it all. How a player thinks is vital.
He throws me five balls.
Just had a good swing of the 3-0 pitch.
Yeah, ball's up here.
I didn't think it was that high. No, it's just the time of spring training that it gets dog days.
Yeah.
Okay, so don't get down. You've been swinging the bat good all spring. Don't let a couple of days affect your mental psyche, all right?
Yeah. You know, I've been hitting the head in the count a lot of days. You know, yesterday I felt, you know, I had some. Well, maybe not yesterday, but
the ball you hit for the double play yesterday, you can't hit a ball hard on that one.
Yeah, I know, but once every 3 days, I mean.
And you got to be smarter in the other situation where you're hitting with a base open and a left-handed hitter on deck with a left-handed pitcher. In spite of not wanting to, you're going to have to look for something off speed.
So, you know, pitching aggressive doesn't mean that you be stupid out there. You got a guy like Hank Aaron up there and you can lose a ball game. You pitch around him.
That's different than, like, in my standpoint, being a short reliever. If I come in the eighth or ninth inning, I've got to go after the guy.
Yes.
There's no way that late in the game if we're ahead, I can't pitch around him.
That's right. You can't pitch around him. You have to go after him. That's your job, is to come in and close the door. And usually you're only going to come in when we're ahead and you're trying to save a ball game. So, you know, your job as a relief pitcher.
Smith or, you know, whoever it is, I've got to go right after him.
Yeah, and with your ball, you got that good sinker ball. I wouldn't be afraid to throw that to anybody. Yeah. I don't care who it is. A guy like me, a guy like Donnie that throws that fastball that comes up a little bit, now we got to be a little more careful than you when we're pitching to those good hitters. You got to, you know, work for the corners more. You can throw a sinker ball right over the middle of the plate,
yeah,
and it goes down good enough where you can get that ground ball. I throw a ball over the middle of the plate, and they may be looking for it on the other side of the fence.
Yeah. Slider, Matt. Yeah.
You know, sometimes we think everything is a big thing, and it's not. It might be a little thing we're doing that can cause everything to happen to us.
You know,
and if it bothers you mentally, that's worse than a physical problem.
I don't know.
Physically or mentally, spring training is just that, training. And they have to train for travel, too.
Yeah, but we might be better off if he's that good a prospect. He's probably better off playing at Richmond. He hadn't even had a year at AAA, right?
He's never been in AAA, but we're trying to find out the best 25 guys to win. We think we're that close.
There are three methods a club uses to reach their final roster: release a player, send him to the minors, or trade him.
I traded you, Detroit.
You traded me.
Just got a call. That's why I took you out of the lineup. They said they might do something, so I had to take you out of the lineup.
Right, okay.
So I guess when you get back home, when we get back tonight, you just check on, you know, where you're supposed to go over there.
All right.
Okay? Good luck, baby.
Thank you.
Okay?
They're planning to use him, Ted, strictly for pinch running late in the game. They've got one of the best outfields in baseball, and Chet Lemon, right, Kurt Gibson, and Herndon. He's not going to get to play over there.
All right. What else? We're really down to not too many decisions, really.
Then we've got Bradford, Matula.
They will leave the warmth of West Palm Beach with 18 wins and 24 exhibition games, the best in all of baseball. But not much attention is paid to that. There have been many great teams in March who've been second division in October. But for this club, it will set the tone for what is to come. Opening night. Oh, there's something very special about it.
That's right. My memorable opening night was not the one in Atlanta where I hit two home runs. It was 0 for 6 in St. Louis.
1968?
69. First year with you guys. First day with you guys. I went 0 for 6. No, we lost, but extra innings, long game. Pittsburgh. That's when Stargell hit a bullet down to me at first, went off my chest into right field. And after the inning, he said to me, "Joe, don't ever get in front of that ball when he hits it like that."
Who said that?
Gibby. I got down in front of that ball, and it just went boom, and we're off into right field somewhere.
A leapfrog.
It has been 13 years since the one and only pennant in Atlanta history. Just one season before, this team finished in fifth place. No one expects much more this time around than fourth. But here they are, opening a season like a team ready to take its place among the best there is.
Fly ball left, Murphy's gonna have to hurry. I believe he caught it, and he did. What a catch by Dale Murphy in left.
Well, there's no doubt that Butler has the ability to steal bases, and he has the speed. The coaching staff is trying to smarten him up a little bit on the base pass. There he goes. Hubbard swings, drive, left center field. It's going to be in there. At least two bases. Here comes Butler. He's going to score. Hubbard stopped at second base. A double, RBI, Braves lead 1-0.
Jones getting his lead down at second. The look in by Rick Mailer. The right-hander stretches. And the 3-2 on the way to Lescano. Strike three swinging, and the Braves have their first season opening victory since 1972.
It's great. It's good that we can jump off and win this one, and I hope we can win tomorrow and just keep it going. We got a great spring. We got a great team.
I didn't think he'd come near the plate. He missed by about 6 inches. Murphy drives one. Deep center field. Jones back to the track. Looks up. Out of here. Home run. Dale Murphy having himself a day.
Little fly ball right, Washington. Can't make it, traps it, throwing to second. He's out. Garber's first pitch. Bouncer to the mound, and this game is going to be over. Garber flips the first, and the Braves win it by a score of 6-4. One pitch by Gene Garber, and he nails it down. Getting the glad hand all around. Joe Torre, all his coaches out.
And now it's Atlanta's turn to see their 2-0 Braves.
Well hit! Should do it. Down to left field, Dale Murphy waves everybody off, and the Braves are 3-0. Houston puts a run on the board in the ninth inning, but Robeski chalks up the save.
Defense would win game number four.
Here's the 0-2 towards second. Great play by Hubbard. There's one, there's two. The inning's over. The defense continues to shine. And at the end,
pretty well hit off the bat of Garner.
Oh, what a catch by Murphy. He's got a chance for a double play. He's got it the Braves way. Rick Camp comes on and gets Art Howe for out number three, and the Braves have won their fourth in a row.
Rick Mailer, the opening night hero, would get his second chance in game five.
Pitch on the way to Cruz. Bouncing ball to first. Here's your ball game. Chris Chambliss steps in the bag. The Braves are 5-0. As Rick Mailer has hurled his second consecutive shutout.
He's been very aggressive. Very aggressive. I mean, he is just going after the hitter and daring the hitter to hit him. And he is he's mixing his pitches well, has command. He's been staying ahead for the most part. When you stay ahead, you can do a lot of things. You know, when you get behind, you're pretty well limited to what you can throw. But when you get ahead, you can do more things. and we've been having great defense behind him. You know, you waste good pitching if you don't have good defense, and we sure as hell have had good defense. Hubbard at second base, Claudel in right field, and Murphy in left field. It's just been all over the place. And the way Benedict's been handling the pitching, you know, it's been overlooked a little bit this week, but he's been doing a hell of a job back there.
It's time for Braves Baseball. Good evening, everybody. Along with Pete Van Wering, this is Ernie Johnson speaking to you from Riverfront Stadium in Cincinnati, where tonight is the Braves against the Reds in game one of a three-game set. The Braves are going for their sixth win in a row. They send Bob Walk to the mound. He'll be opposed by Bruce Perini.
The Braves' power would win games six and seven. But in number eight, it would be the defense again, along with some late inning magic.
One on right, on left. Ramirez, did he catch it? He caught it! It'll be a double play! It'll be a double play! Ramirez caught it, he turned, they double the runner at second.
Base hit, one run is in, two runs will score. Benedict is on his way to third. Ramirez tries for second, he will make it. Rafael with another big clutch hit, Atlanta by three, and that's exactly what Kern did. And that should be in the ball game. Dale Murphy draws a bead, and it's eight straight for Atlanta. Rick Camp does the job. Benedict, Linares, heroes as well. Ken Smith, a big clutch walk. Ramirez, a big hit. Atlanta wins at 5-2.
As far as any records, I, you know, at the end of the year, we win the pennant and all that stuff, then I'll look back on records. But right now, we're really looking forward to tomorrow night and coming out here and hoping to win. Well, I love it. You know, and it's... They see our, you know, because of my boss, they see us all over the country, and I'm just happy we're showing them a good product, and I'm proud of the way they're playing out there.
In game nine, Nolan Ryan and his 93-mile-an-hour fastball had an early 3-0 lead over the Braves.
They have three hits, Astros have seven. That one bounces by him. Wild pitch, Butler scores, we're all tied up. We're all ready. Shot, fair ball down the third baseline. Murphy rounds second base. Ball kicks away from Cruz. Here comes Murphy being waved down by Maxville. He's going to score. Corner with a double. And the breaks keep coming for the Braves.
Bottom half of the ninth inning. One man out. The runner at third base is Art Howe. The runner at first base, Dickey Thon. 1-0 pitch comes to Garner. Bouncing ball to third. There's one. There's two. And the Braves are 9-0. Rick Camp out of the bullpen does his job, getting Garner to hit into a 5-4-3 double play. And tomorrow night, the Atlanta Braves will be trying to tie an all-time National League record for the most consecutive wins at the start of a season. The Braves are 9-0. There goes the runner, 3-2 pitch, line drive down the left field line, fair ball, rolling into the corner, Glenn Hubbard scores. Dale Murphy being waved around third, he will score. Bob Horner in at second with a stand-up double, two runs are in, and the Braves take a 2-0 lead.
The windup, 1-2, let up, Braves win! Braves win! Gene Garber! And look at that team! 10 in a row! They've tied a record set by the Dodgers of 55 and the Pittsburgh Pirates of 62. What a ball game. We hope that you enjoyed it.
And now, the stage was set.
Hi, everybody. Along with Ernie Johnson, this is Pete Van Wern welcoming you to the Astrodome in Houston, Texas, where this afternoon the Braves try to enter the Major League record books for the second straight day. Last night, a 2-1 victory gave the Braves 10 straight wins to start the season. That tied the National League record set in 1955 by the Brooklyn Dodgers, tied in 1962 by the Pittsburgh Pirates. Today, the Braves take aim at the 1981 Oakland A's. Billy Ball. The A's won their first 11 games last year. The Braves trying to match that record here today. Here's the payoff. Runners going. Drive, deep right center field. Walling back, way back. Off the wall. Murphy's at second base. One run's going to score. Horner's being waved in. Murphy's to third. The play at the plate. No play at the plate. The ball's cut off. Nipper winds a 3-2. Curveball swung on, driven right field. Back goes Heap. He can't get to it. Murphy's going to score easily. Chambliss around first base. Stops at second base with a double. We're all tied up at four.
And a one-strike pitch on the way to Biff Pokorova.
Line drive, left center field, base hit, Chris Chambliss scores. This one's going to roll all the way to the warning track. Around third, Rafael Ramirez, and the Braves lead it 6-4 as Biff Pokorova delivers a two-run pinch hit double.
One ball, two strikes, two outs. Ashby gets his lead from third. Here's the 1-2, right back to camp. This is going to do it. Yes, the Braves have just entered the record book along with the Oakland A's. Move over, Billy Ball. Make room for the 1982 Atlanta Braves.
The Braves didn't know it, but over 6,000 excited fans would be waiting at the airport in Atlanta for these record setters to come home.
Game 12. No other team in history had ever won that many in a row to start a season. Close to 38,000 gathered to watch. And those at home heard Skip Carey at his best.
Look at those placards. They're going crazy here, and we love it.
Having fun. I was having a lot of fun. I had told my wife, and I told a couple guys here on Sunday, that we're going to win number 12 on Tuesday, and I was going to be the pitcher. You know, I wanted to be. I'd have paid a lot of money to be out there on that night. I didn't tell Joe that, or he might have waited until I paid him, but I would have paid him money to go out there to pitch his last couple innings, and because I love playing under this situation. That's fun.
The fun was just beginning, but it wouldn't seem so in the bottom of the ninth in game 13. Cincinnati leads it 3-2 as Ernie Johnson calls the action.
Here's a 3-1 to Sinatra. Inside ball four, tying run at first. Sinatra runs well. Ramirez the batter. Sinatra at first. Here comes Rufino Linares to the on-deck circle. Bunt is in order. And it's made. Oh! All hands are safe! Ramirez on a push bunt, got it by Shirley. The Braves trying to pull it out in the ninth. They trail by one. First and second and nobody out. Runners. Sinatra second, Ramirez first. Now the 1-2 pitch to Rufi. Fly ball, left center, the tag by Sinatra. Catch, throw, back to second. First and second, now one out. As Linares fails to move him, now Butler. Two on and one out. The hits are even at nine. Hit to short. Oh, bad hop! Here comes Sinatra! Tie game! Oh, the Braves are living right. Wait a minute. It might not be. Let's see. There are runners first and second. They're trying to, now we're going to take another look. Ramirez is going back to second, I believe. Here's Butler hitting the ball. Let's see if we can pick it up.
I think you might be able to see it here. Concepcion right away complaining to the umpire that hit him in the heel. Right there.
It did hit him. So that's going to be two outs. That's a call, two outs. Butler gets a base hit. We thought it was a bad hop. It hit the runner. It'll keep it at 3-2. Sinatra hit by the ground ball. Runners first and second. It's an automatic hit for Butler. But now two outs. And Jim Curran is a new pitcher. So the Braves are down to one out. Runners first and second. Curran in a 3-2 game. Hulk already. And the pitch. Gets away. Runners go by. It'll be a wild pitch. And Claudel Washington is the batter. They've got a lefty loosening in the bullpen, so there might be some heat on a left-hander to pitch to Washington. Curran with a 3-0. Hoko gets a walk. His run means nothing, but they got to play at every base. But it also puts a little heat on the new pitcher. Joe Price has 8 warm-up tosses. Now Frank Pulley says, let's play ball. Hits the bottom of the ninth. The base is loaded and two outs. Into the motion. First pitch. Inside, almost hit it.
13 straight wins to open the season. That was something. That established a new big league record. And of course, there was excitement in Atlanta and at the stadium.
Oh, just to make history and to know that we're in there with Willie and the Duke and all them, I'll tell you, now you can make a song about the Bravos, huh? But boy, that's just great. I can't believe it.
We're part of Major League Baseball history, and that's something that all the players that played in this game or on this team are going to remember.
Well, the only time I was ever in the record books before this was hitting the four double plays in one game, so this is definitely on the plus side of the ledger.
Lucky. During the excitement, everybody was anxious to take in these streaking young men.
And we're so proud of the Braves that therefore we're going to take this extremely serious step. The within and foregoing petition of the Senior Citizen Atlanta Multipurpose Center participants, petitioners being presented seeking the adoption of the Atlanta Braves baseball team. Ted Turner, owner. Joe Torre, manager. Bob Horner, captain. Wayne Menchu, public relations director. Herein named, said team to be known when adopted as grandchildren of the Atlanta Multipurpose Center. Yay! Hereby signed this 13th day of May, 1982, W. Paul Carpenter, Jr., Multipurpose Center Director and Judge, Superior Court of Goodwill, SCS Judicial Circuit, 3410th Street, blah, 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 Al Horvath, Executive Director, and Joe Torre, Atlanta Braves. It's done!
Be it known to this court present that the Atlanta Braves baseball team does hereby consent to the adoption of this team as grandchildren by the participants of the Atlanta Multipurpose Senior Center, Atlanta, Georgia. Signed by Joe Torre, manager, Wayne Menchu, and initialed by Ted Turner and Bob Horner. Thank you.
And I just want to echo what Wayne said. I think it's great, and I just hope you people don't forget this. If things start going a little shaky, don't lock the door on us if we need some place to hide. Some of our games have probably added a few years to your life. Some of them might have shortened it, but hopefully by the end of the year, you're a whole lot younger than you are right now, at least feel that way. Again, on behalf of the ball club, I really appreciate this honor, and hopefully we get a chance to come and see you some more with more good news. Thank you.
Oh, one pitch. He bunts it. A good bunt. Can he beat it out? Nice play by the pitcher, Floyd Schiffer. Walk does not agree with the call over there, and Joe Torre's going to come out and have a few words with Bob Davison, first base umpire.
He was closer to being out the first time than that. He was a foot past the bag, I swear to God. It wasn't even close that time.
Joe, I saw it good.
He wasn't even close. You were watching it. I'm not going to deny that, but you missed the... That's all I'm going to say. Jesus!
We have met this dark-eyed man before, but who is he? How is he able to manage a collection of 25 distinctly different human beings? Can we paint a portrait with a brush of words? He is quite simply a baseball manager.
You know I'm bothering you?
No.
Huh?
No.
Don't now.
No, I'm not.
Sure?
Yes. That last slide was...
You just drop down, you aim the ball. Well, don't be a hero. Your arm bothers me, I want you to tell you.
No, it doesn't.
Okay, go after it then.
Right.
Come on. You watching, Sonny?
On that play right there? No.
Okay, you gotta watch.
Oh, you have something on?
You never know. I'm thinking of putting something on. The thing is, once you don't watch, they know nothing's on. You know what I mean? So there's a situation, hubby. Hubby. There's a situation. If you just bunt the ball to the second baseman, it's a run. Not a thing they can do about it. He's playing back for the double play. You get it past the pitcher, it's bye.
Sometimes a manager can get to know his players so well, he can even predict their next moves.
We have one down. We're in the bottom of the 10th inning. The Braves score here. They go seven games up on the San Diego Padres.
Herbie always does it. You know that? First pitch, too. You can't pitch around him because you have to face the monster after this guy. First pitch, I told you, didn't I? First pitch! Told you, first pitch!
First pitch.
A manager might know his players well, but he can never know the umpire well enough.
A runner at first, Baker, with two down. He looks like he's going to wind up. Or did he?
He balked.
He did. He started to wind up. Pascual Perez started up. Joe Torre and Bob Gibson don't agree.
I'm not arguing. It's not a step balk. He was back off the rubber, though. He stepped back off the rubber. Yes, he did.
No, he didn't.
He stepped back, Billy.
No, he didn't.
He stepped back.
What? He said he's out.
No. He was off the rubber.
Stop.
He did this. He stepped back up. No. Why don't you get some help from the side?
He called it, too. Joe called it from the side.
He stepped back with his 3 foot. I called it the same time he did. He stepped back with the foot on the rubber.
Disengage the rubber, you must stop.
I know that. That's what he just did back here. He did it from, you could see it from over there, Billy. It's not a trip, is it? I'm arguing with you. I mean, it's a trip to the mound. I'm just talking about it. It's not a trip, is it?
You didn't say nothing
to me. No. I can't. He doesn't understand English.
And then you want me to talk.
Well, I told you to talk to Ramirez.
The name manager is all-encompassing. It can mean cheerleader.
Come on, Captain. Hit one, Captain. Get us that run back. Got to score when they score. Come on, man. That's the one we want now. Let's go. Come on. A little more life. Let's go. It's the game we want. Come on, CW.
And the 0-1 pitch. Line drive left field. Base hit. Watson will be green-lighted around third. Here's the throw by Gwynn. Cut off. The throw to third. They get him at third, but the run does score.
He might have had him at the plate.
Manager can also mean strategy.
Say he's going to be the hitter now. We're going to walk the next two guys. You can back up a step or two and still get a double play on him. Okay? If that ball's hit on a bounce charge, that's come get him because he can't run. So he can take a step. Don't go back, but just a little bit. All right?
What are you trying to do with him? I prefer to stay away on him. Come in off the plate. That ball had too much of the plate, obviously, right? In a situation now, you can get him out of the way, all right?
Okay.
Come on, finish this simple. Come on.
And sometimes, even frustrated strategies.
Think of something. I'm fine in getting guys on. I choke up and get them in.
I forgot to give him the suicide sign. Forgot to give him the squeeze sign. Anyway, because they pitched out on the pitch I wanted to give it to them. Let somebody else take over when you get a man on third. I quit.
The manager must be an instructor.
Little pop-up short center field. Ramirez going out, Murphy coming in. Ramirez can't see it, and Murphy can't either. That'll be a base hit.
Rob, you didn't see that at all? Oh, you saw it first and then you lost? Okay, especially this time of night, try not to take your eye off it. You know, when you go out, if you're looking for something, just keep your eye on it this time of night. Once you have it, try keeping it, okay? Because once you take your eye off it to see if where you are, and then you go back, you won't find it again. Just try to keep your eye. If you lose it, you lose it. There's nothing you can do about it. Well, he saw it at first. And then, the problem is when you go out there and you're sort of looking to see who's coming, you know what I mean?
And oh, yes. He must be a disciplinarian.
We have to get together on a fine for the other day. I'd like to break your neck. I didn't even know you were missing.
You did?
No, not until they said, where's Royster? I take you for granted.
Just 7 months before, he was out of work, fired by the New York Mets. They didn't say much to him when he left. But now, on his first return, they can't get enough of him. His words meant little 7 months before. His team was a loser. Winning has made him a hot item again.
It's the question that you've been asked for a million and one time. How does it feel to be back?
That's strange, strange being back. I haven't been in this dugout since 74. And I'm more concerned about how, badly my ball club's been playing for the last week as opposed to coming back here.
Do you find that this is a, you'd rather not have a game like this with the emotion pumped up in the minds of the Mets and the Braves at this point?
Well, I don't think the emotion is as much in the minds of my ball club, you know, as maybe it might be in your mind. You know, my players have been coming here, and there's nothing different except they have a different manager. And because I have played here and managed here, doesn't mean there's any more significance for this game for them as opposed to, you know, you think it is for me. And it is for me because it's strange being in this dugout.
With your knowledge of the Mets, do you find you're at an advantage, or with the changes, do you find that you may be at a disadvantage?
Well, we lost two out of three there, so obviously my knowledge didn't work. But it's... you know, you think you know them a little bit, but I don't think you know them any more than, except personally, any more than any scouting report could give you about any other club.
New York, his old hometown, gives Joe Torre a chance not only to play a game, but to show off one of his favorite restaurants to his coaching staff.
Kiss today, goodbye. The sweetness and the sorrow. We need what we had to do, and I can't regret what I did for love, what I did for love. Look, my eyes are dry.
To Joe Ponte with this one.
The gift was ours to borrow. Salute. It's as if it's always new, but I won't forget what I did for love, what I did for love. Gone, love is never gone. As we travel on, love's what will remain. Kiss me, and call me for tomorrow. Wish me luck the same to you. Won't forget, can't regret what I did for love, what I did for love, what I did for love.
They ate together. They laughed together, but most important, they worked together. Joe Torre can do no more than stand by with his constant companions in the dugout and pull the strings.
We get a lead, should we bring McWilliams in? Two left-handers coming up. Buckner and Durham. Then you can bring Camp in to get the right-hander out. Huh?
If he gets the two guys out, then he might as well let him pitch to the, you know?
Did you make it clear to these guys when you talked about striking guys out outside that you meant right-hander on right-hander? Who we got, Rube? Let's get out of an inning with.
Garber. Hannah.
Alvarez. Who do you want to get out of an inning with? Better use Garber.
Their dugout conversation isn't limited to their own 25 men.
I was hearing rumors about a Yankee trade. Madlock going to the Yankees. Bucky Dent, pitcher.
Here's Willie McGee. He'll bat righty.
Another Irishman they come up with. First McBride, then McGee. You know who? They keep coming up with Irishmen. McBride, McGee.
And up steps Dave Kingman, who's had a very unusual season. He's number two in the National League in home runs with 28. He's up among the league leaders in RBIs with 72, but he's batting only 199.
Kingman, he said Kingman's hitting everything away.
Hitting the ball away? Who said that?
Westrum.
Where's he hitting it?
He's pulling everything.
Over here, fine.
So he's pulling everything.
The ball away, he's pulling?
Strikes away, I guess. To me, he likes the ball inside, doesn't he?
Well, he likes it right down the middle.
Yeah.
Where he likes
it. An inside strike.
And there is no better way to pass the time than reflection.
Pouzy really challenged me all the time, wouldn't he? Homering that right field line on him all the time. Then he threw me a breaking ball and I pulled down left field.
Got old Fergie in my book, Rube.
You got Fergie in there?
Center field, Chicago. Up in that, on that little tarp up there.
Wind blowing in.
Yeah, blowing in. Turn it around.
I usually hit the homer opening day to give Gibson a 1-1 tie.
Yeah, and then he takes me out. God, it really f***ed me off. I said, Red, what the f*** you doing? You're going to win the pennant the first day of the season? Take me out before fifth inning. We'd be behind 1-0.
I know, the thing that helped me after I got beamed was to get traded. You know? I got traded, I can't embarrass myself now. They traded a good player for me. I had to play. I don't care where you hit me again.
Well, they did the same thing, and he got traded.
Oh, I know. I'm saying that's...
Who did we trade over there? Nobody?
Reardon.
Jeff Reardon, that's right.
I'm just saying the way it affected me, you know?
Yeah.
Sometimes, though not often, they don't talk about baseball at all.
There's something wrong with my glasses, Joe. I'm not seeing like I should be seeing out of these things.
I gotta get a haircut. Or wait till I go to St. Louis. Guy gives good haircuts, bro.
What I'm doing? You wanna get up in the morning and watch me on Good Morning America tomorrow?
No. What time? 7 o'clock?
7:40.
I'll be up by then.
5-0 Philadelphia.
What are you going to do on Good Morning America?
Talk to David Hartman.
Yeah, that's a long trip, isn't it? What time you got to leave tonight?
Same as going to Ponte's.
Cheese people? Okay, the cheese people. To the average fan, such a name would mean little. But it was to become the rallying cry of this team, the cheese people. What does it mean?
That's an interesting question. I don't really know. It just happened. It's just a phrase saying that somebody came up with.
It's a slogan. I think every ball club, you know, whether win or lose, always has a slogan they go by. And this is what this ball club picked up.
Cheese, because the best.
We're already referred to as America's team because we go to so many homes. I think that the little slogan that we've come up with is a team thing, and I think it should stay that way.
The cheese people!
By now, the cheese people would know that this would be a special season. Magical. Sometimes it seemed all they had to do was whisper abacadabra.
I heat up, I can't cool down. Got me spinning round and round. Round and round and round it goes. Where it stops, nobody knows. Every time you call my name, I heat up like a burning flame. Burning flame, full of desire. Kiss me, baby, let the fire get higher.
A few of these cheese people would heat up enough to be invited to the game that the big cheese play, the All-Star game. An outfielder named Dale Murphy. A third baseman named Bob Horner. And a pitcher named Phil Niekroff. There to be honored, but there also to face another barrage of newsmen. Who are these guys from Atlanta anyway?
Everything get squared away?
It's fine.
This is really kind of a tribute to the team, I think, because the team's doing well and people have heard of us, you know, and all the way up here in Montreal. And so it's just, I think, the recognition is part of the fact that the team's doing good.
I think Horner deserves to be on the All-Star team. He's added a lot to his credits this year. He's having a good year, plus the fact that I think he's going to be the hero of the game. And he's been a tremendous ball player, and I've always liked and respected Murph as a ball player and also as a human being.
You know, there's a certain amount of history, pride behind the National League All-Star teams. I think the National League players, even before it starts, realizes that, you know, you have to get selected for the All-Star team. You're not just going up there to make a great play or hit a home run. You're going up to be part of a team that's going to win a ball game.
It's just so hectic. You don't really get the gist of what's going on until you get out there on the field. And you see the guys across the field, and they're the best in their league, and we're the best in our league, and you just get caught up in the whole thing.
Nolan Ryan looking in for his sign. Pitch on the way to Ruffino. Ooh, right on the right arm. Ruffino is down. He's hurting, and here comes trainer Dave Pursley out to take a look.
Right on the hand, Dave.
Huh?
Right on the hand.
This hand?
This hand, that leg, this elbow, all in the care of Dave Pursley, the trainer.
Hey, here it is. Wait a second, man. This is where it hit you, right? Let me freeze it one time, Eric.
What do you think?
I feel good.
one of the biggest things for us is very little small injuries, that like blisters on the fingers and a stole finger from getting hit with the ball, or get hit in the hand while they're hitting. These are really not serious injuries, but if you can't throw the ball, you can't play baseball.
They had to come up here to... Hot shot, Nuxie doesn't know where it is. Now he does. He's safe at first. Let's see if he's all right. You saw there the instinct of a great athlete. He was stunned by that ball.
You scratching the chin, Nuxie? Some choppers.
Dizzy?
Huh? Man, I throw the ball way over there?
No. Just a little wide off, yeah.
I had to pull off.
That's a...
He didn't know what day it was when he got to the park today.
How many kids you got?
I feel like I'm going to get out of the inning here.
Hey, next one, I'll throw a couple.
Throw a couple, just see how the jolt got you?
Yeah. All right.
Got a headache?
Headaches are Persler's specialty. So are knees and backs. It is his job to keep 25 men able to play baseball daily. The headache, then, is usually his.
Okay.
Dave Persler's job is most essential, but try to play the game without him. You could play it without the lucky kids known as the bat boys, but it would be tough. Who would the poor umpire have to talk to?
How many years have you been here now? Three or four?
Four.
Four?
Yeah.
It's about time for you to retire, isn't it?
This is my last year.
Who would polish and clean the shoes? He is in at 10 in the morning and leaves 2 hours after the game that night. And though the players don't often thank him for such hours, they reward him in other, stranger ways.
He could be hitting 090. I wonder why you picked your feet up.
That's $25 right there. Whoever did that, look, burned a hole in my shoe. You know, sometimes I wonder why ball clubs don't carry psychiatrists with them, just as they do trainers. Joe Torre's philosophy as a manager is just the same as that of every other manager, to try and keep the ball club away from peaks and valleys, try and keep it playing at an even tempo. But it just doesn't work. This team wins the first 13, loses the next five. Wins 9, loses 11. On Tuesdays, plays perfect ball. On Wednesdays, things go wrong. Bases on balls, errors, missed signs. But there's no reason to get all frustrated about it. Every team goes through it, and for good reasons.
See Joe Colley and Bob Welsh opposing each other in the second game, and Landro drives one deep right field. If it stays fair, it's trouble. That ball is out of here, a home run.
Well hit to right field. Linares going back on the warning track. He'll not be able to get it. It's out of here. A two-run homer for Ron Say, and the Dodgers get a couple of runs closer. It's now 8-5.
Pitching line. Giveaway. Giveaway. Joke. Question. Before guys get on there. Damn it, let's go.
Nothing would typify the tenor of this losing streak more than one moment in Dodger Stadium. Braves leading 2-1. Bottom of the ninth, two out. Here's Pete Van Wieren.
Garber shaking off a couple of signs. Now he's got the one he wants. And the pitch on the way to Monday. Bouncing ball to second base.
Just don't let things like that happen too often, and obviously they don't. That's why so much attention has been brought upon what I did. You make a mistake like I did, it happens once a year or twice a year as far as all the teams are concerned. So, you know, like I said, the attention has been enormous since then, since I made the error. But, you know, if it had happened in the first or second inning, nobody would have probably even remembered that it happened.
Ross DeZella would not be the last during this long weekend in Los Angeles.
And here we go. Popped him up right side. Chambliss, Hubbard, Washington. It's going to be a three-run and a fair ball, and Sayers at second base. Holy smoke. High shot, Ramirez, booked it in the ball game. Over.
1-2, the count to Chris. Lined off the pitcher's glove. Harper got a late break. Now the throw to the plate. He's going to...
Personally, I think right now what the Braves are going through is what all clubs go through during the course of the year. The good ones, it happens once. The bad ones, it happens two and three and four times a year.
Hell, you know, you're going to make errors. You're human. You know, and if it was a mental thing where a guy, you know, did something stupid, That's one thing. But a physical error is something that is part of the game. Just like a base hit.
You can't get too high and you can't get too low in this game because there's too many games to play and you can be humbled, you know, quick. And that's what we're doing right now. We're getting humbled.
It's a man's game. It's a man's game. And this game is over with. There's not a damn thing you can do about it anymore. You got to look to tomorrow, and that's what we have to do.
But tomorrow, or the rest of the week, wouldn't get any better.
A 5-3 Atlanta lead, the 2-0 pitch. High fly ball into shallow right field. Second baseman Glenn Hubbard back. Look at the wind bring that thing back, and he dropped it. Hubbard dropped it, and safe at first is Darrell Evans.
Negro.
Center, Murphy glasses down, battles the sun, the ball gets away, runners will be at second and third with nobody up. Outfield in at Little League depth, so the infield. The Braves should have won this game 5-1. In reality, they lose it 6-5.
For half the season, this team had a lock on first place. But now, they've watched it slip away.
Sliding away, slip sliding away. You know the nearer your destination, oh, you slip sliding away, slip sliding away, slip sliding away. You know the nearer your destination, oh, you slip sliding away.
Bedrosian lost five games?
Yep, this is since July 29, after we finished the sweep.
This is like midway for the Japanese.
Upon their arrival back in Atlanta, Ted Turner would call for a summit meeting.
It's been a rough 2 weeks, I know. It's been rough on everybody, I'm sure. It's been rough on me. Because there's nothing I could do about it. And I'm sure it's been rough on you because there's a limited amount that, the guys are just, they just clutched up.
Yeah. Yeah, they got tight. They got tight. We had several meetings and tried to loosen everybody up, and they seemed pretty good after a few of those meetings. Just told them they weren't having enough fun out in the field.
They did a good job when we were leading of not getting too up, but I guess they, deep in their hearts, they smartly knew that this could happen, and I guess they were just, you know, if they'd have gotten dizzyingly high and gone around and said we're going to whomp everybody, it would have, because I always say pride goeth before a fall, and whom the gods would destroy first they indulge. My father always used to tell me that when I thought things were going good. You know, that's true. That's an old saying, you know, that, you know, right before you die, you get everything you want. You know, it's like a condemned man that's going to be executed the next day, gets his choice of food the night before. That's his last meal. The question is, what, I mean, I'm sure y'all have asked yourselves, what do we got to do to snap out of it? I mean, it looks like it's just about everybody. I mean, you're not, when they break down defensively and offensively, the pitchers haven't got a chance, right?
Yeah, but the pitchers have been doing their share, too.
Right. They have, but mainly it's, yeah, that's true.
We've played through this whole thing.
This is where a game in the AFL.
And we're tied on the loss side.
I realize that, but I mean, you know, if it...
No, I'm not saying...
Another 2 weeks of this, and, I mean, I remember when we lost 17 games in a row. Well, how many did we lose? 11 was the most we lost in a row during this, this run. Well, okay, gang. I mean, I've been here before. Never been 10 games over 500 on the 17th of August, 16th.
The losses multiply. Frustration festers. How does a baseball team handle such disaster? Where does it go for solace? As lonely as the game can be, there is always the warmth of the locker room, their working home, a place to hide themselves, to lift their disgruntled teammates.
Well, he got ahead of me and threw me an inside pitch, and I just fought it off, and luckily I went right up the middle. But, hey, you guys mellow out, right?
Turn around, Rick.
Behalf of the Atlanta Braves, we'll give you the best number in the...
No, is that your number, Rick?
Atlanta Braves.
Thank you.
Balloons by the bunch. Your American team, your our team, your local fans in Chippewa Falls, Wisconsin.
For some, a corner of the locker room is space to share the search for something more than hits and runs.
We just thank you, Lord, for the privilege of being here today and just gathering your name in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen. This song really kind of typifies, as we travel around and look at the country, how we see God in nature, and we're awed at His beauty and His love for us. This song's called "Who Am I." Sky. And Lord, it makes me wonder why.
I see the flowers growing wild. Pure and simple as a child.
It's a tough one.
That's about it. You need a couple rolls going around there, man. Come on, man.
I think I got about 30
back here. Oh, man. That's 4 rolls we used right there. That's a Dave Perley tape job right there. Nice, guys.
Any other questions?
He's got his clothes on there, something like that.
Yeah. Where's Rock at? I'm gonna get you in your clothes.
Well, we can't find anybody to talk to today. I guess that's the Murph! Big Murph! Come here, Murph. Just one question, please. Murph, the Braves are playing good ball, and we take this last game into Philly now, and we go up to Montreal. What do you look for?
Well, it's gonna be another tough ball game tomorrow night. We're just playing one at a time, and I think as long as we can keep Bedrock out of there, we got a chance.
Thank you very much, Dale. That was Dale Murphy, the Atlanta Braves, number 4 hitter in the lineup. We're back after this message.
The frustration remains. Losing is life's most difficult challenge. These cheese people, as they call themselves, have seen their 9-game lead dwindle to nothing. No clubhouse pranks, no chapel service. Nothing can remove the horror on their faces as they desperately try to reverse things. Perhaps there is no Brave more frustrated than this young pitcher, Tommy Boggs. A wealth of talent, threatened early in the season by the most feared of pitching injuries, a torn rotator cuff in his right shoulder.
Yeah, I've stayed with the ball club. I think it's probably helped me the most by doing that. I think if I would have stayed home, it would have been a lot harder to keep myself in shape. But I have to come out here every day to the ballpark. I have to go through the same ritual every day, lifting weights and doing my running. And I got to a point where I was throwing full speed again. I felt great. And then the next 2 days later, I went out and I couldn't even throw a ball 50 feet, and it really bothered me. And I think at that time, mentally, I had a letdown. I think for about a week there, I was really down, and I didn't do the work that I probably should have been doing.
And I just think it's important for Boggsy right now to try to get this game under his belt and come out of it healthy. And from there, we'll probably send him, we will send him to Richmond where he can pitch in a rotation for a couple of weeks and ready to come back and help us.
It's just a matter of redeveloping it, really. It's not a matter of anything else except just pitching, actually, you know, pitching as much as I can.
Basically, you're ready now to go down to Richmond.
I'm ready. I think if my arm feels like that every time, I'm ready to pitch every fifth day. You know, now it's just a matter of how it's going to feel 2 days from now. You know, if it feels good in 2 days, I'll be ready.
But who will know when Tommy Boggs is ready? He will return to the Braves ahead of schedule, anxious to become a working part of the team again. But in the estimation of the coaches, he is not as ready as he figured. And the boss wants to know, what in the world happened this time?
Before we brought Boggs up, who talked to say?
I talked to the manager mostly, Ted.
When it's a pitcher like that, you ought to be talking to Sane.
Well,
Sane didn't feel like he was ready to pitch in the big leagues anyway. But nobody asked him. I don't want any pitcher ever brought up from Richmond again without you and Torre talking to Johnny Sane if he's coming from Richmond, because we were a pitcher short that game. I mean, all it would have taken was a phone call, and we would have known that he wasn't ready to pitch. But neither one of you even asked.
I was there.
Yeah, well, I mean, there's absolutely no excuse for you not asking, because you were there.
I was there.
Why didn't you ask?
Talk to Tommy. Tommy was all excited about coming back.
Well, why didn't you talk to Sane?
I talked to Hayes mostly.
Well, why didn't you talk to Sane? He's the pitching coach. We're paying him a major league pitching coach's salary.
Well,
I mean, there's one error on management, but we didn't have a policy on it. I'm just saying, in the future, that's going to be the policy. I don't want, if it's a everyday player, you talk to Eddie Haas, and you talk to him too. So I'll be damn sure there was two talking, okay?
Yes, sir.
And if it's a pitcher, talk to Haas and the Sane. You at least talk to Haas and the Sane, and you be sure to talk to Sane if it's a pitcher.
The first real step on his comeback trail would be taken in Philadelphia. Tommy Boggs would throw his first major league pitch in months, and it would be a winner.
And the two-strike pitch on the way from Boggs. Caught the outside corner, Rose down on three straight pitches, and so far, so good for Tommy.
You start going back a little further. I guess you're just trying to reach back to get a little more, and you start leaning back.
Even the three sliders to Schmidt there, so when he finally ground out, I can't get it out there. I'm coming here. Must be leaning back, not coming over.
That's been a long time. You get it.
Diaz getting his lead. Here's the look over by Boggs. And a pitch on the way to Maddox. Little tap toward third. Horner handles it on to second. There's one. Hubbard's relay to first in time. Double play.
Feel pretty strong?
Yeah.
Okay. I just want to take a little time and get him started down there.
Sure. Yeah. I got a ground ball here.
Okay, don't get the rear end back too much now. You're getting a little tired now. You're starting to lean back. Okay, go get him now.
We'll get some activity in the Braves bullpen now as Gene Garber begins to loosen up.
If he doesn't get this guy out, it's his last hitter, so have him crank it up. Either way.
One out here in the bottom half of the sixth inning, which may be the last inning for Tommy Boggs, who had an 80-pitch limit placed upon him for this, his first major league start since April 20th. Pete Rose, the runner at first, the count 1-1 on Manny Trejo. Rose gets his lead as Boggs looks in for a sign. The check of the runner. And the 1-1 offering. Trejo hits a little tap up the middle. Ramirez has it to his left in time for one on to first, double play, and the inning's over. Six scoreless innings of work for Tommy Boggs.
Nobody is happier than his teammates. For if they are to break out of this slump, they know he'd be an integral key.
All right. Way to go, Tommy.
You know, it's great to see a guy go out there and have an outing like that. You know, I can't even remember the last time we had a shutout. And especially for him, I know he's happy about it, having all the arm trouble he's had. And for this team right now and the situation we're in right now, it's great. I love it.
Well, we certainly needed a lift, and this is going to help. Anything would help, and we were just pleased that he pitched so well.
I said when Tommy got hurt, if he pitches any more before the end of the year, it'll be a bonus. So this is our bonus.
I haven't felt left out on this team. For 4 months I haven't pitched and I haven't felt left out. They've still, treated me as a teammate even though I haven't pitched. And that's a great feeling. It gives you a little more confidence and makes you work harder to come back. And, you know, I just hope I can help this team win down the stretch.
Fortunately, the healing process ended just when the team needed him the most. And that was typical of the entire season. Just when it seemed they couldn't suffer any longer, they didn't have to. I suppose you're wondering why I'm on this overpass outside of Atlanta. Cars and trucks streaming by underneath me. That's a good question. And we've got a great answer for you. But you'll have to wait until tomorrow night to get it. That's when the Braves collapse ended. This is the old redhead saying, we'll see you then.
Stay tuned for scenes from tomorrow night's part two of It's a Long Way to October. Tomorrow night on part two of It's a Long Way to October, the league's most valuable player provides his manager with some of the most frustrating moments.
I'm looking for something and swung at something else. I'd like to take his head and put it between two cymbals and just go like that.
And the 2-1 Rick
Mayer. The pitching staff didn't help much either.
3-1, 2-0. 3-1.
The strange part about it, Ted, is when they do pitch the way we teach them, they're successful.
Well, why? Then it's your... It's like if your children don't do what you told them to do.
We can only put them between the lines. We can't go out there and stand behind them.
Yeah, you can go out there. You can go out there once in any.
Once, and we do.
The umpires have some quiet moments.
And now the end is near. You saw our face this fountain.
And some not-so-quiet moments.
Rusty was right in here. I mean, Horner was running right in here.
Horner was around over here.
Go ahead.
We'll take you on the road from the French cuisine in Montreal to the seafood in San Francisco. The players hold their own award ceremony.
But I wanted to really honor Maxie for putting up with us for missing. I've never seen a team miss so many signs in all my life.
We'll take you down the stretch with this baseball team. The scoreboard watching. Take a look at the bottom two lines. The Dodgers had the bases loaded in the 10th inning with nobody out. The excitement. And you will experience the anxious final moments to victory.
With 13 hits and 5 RBIs.
But one warning,
don't wear good clothes. You will be in the middle of one of the wildest champagne parties in history.
It's a Long Way to October has been brought to you by Cable News Network, America's most important network, and by CNN Headline News, America's headline service. Now you have a choice in 24-hour television news from Turner Broadcasting System. If you don't have CNN and CNN Headline News, contact your cable operator today.
Following is a TBS Sports special presentation. They call themselves the cheese people, but only they know why.
It's a slogan I think every ball club, whether win or lose, always has a slogan they go by, and this is what this ball club picked up.
Cheese, because the best.
Their 13-game winning streak to open the season put this team in the record book.
Down, we're in the bottom of the 10th inning.
A manager really gets to know his players through the long baseball season.
Herbie always does it, you know that?
First pitch, too.
You can't pitch around him because you have to face the monster after this guy.
First pitch, I told you, didn't I? First pitch! Told you, first pitch!
But sometimes his mind isn't only on baseball.
I gotta get a haircut. I'll wait till I go to St. Louis. Guy gives good haircuts, bro.
The players find their own way to pass the time. After holding first place for half the season, suddenly the cheese went rancid.
Second base is in the center field. And a run for San Diego.
Little pop, short right center. Murphy glasses down, battles the sun. The ball gets away.
Back in Atlanta, the boss wanted to know what in the world was going on.
What do we got to do to snap out of it? I mean, it looks like it's just about everybody.
It's a Long Way to October, brought to you by Cable News Network, America's most important network, and by CNN Headline News, America's headline service. Now you have a choice in 24-hour television news from Turner Broadcasting System. If you don't have CNN and CNN Headline News, contact your cable operator today.
And now the conclusion to It's a Long Way to October.
This is the highway that circles the city of Atlanta. It's 64 miles around and has 45 exits. Each year, more than 40 million cars traveling. And it's strange, but along here somewhere, the fortunes of the Chiefs people turned around. They'd lost 19 of 21 games. that seen their big lead in the West Division of the National League completely disappear when fate, in the form of one man's desperation, stepped in. A player lost, a team found.
Sin darme cuenta, ya pasado, bueno, tenía que coger la 85. No quise regresar para atrás, entonces lo que me perdí más, porque entonces traté de buscar la entrada y nunca la encontré. Y pasé como 5 veces por el mismo sitio. Y ahí me cogí casi 3 horas dando vueltas. Entonces, cuando vi la vuelta, la última vez que vi la vuelta, entonces me paré en la bomba. Y le dije al muchacho que yo no tenía gasolina y que yo era pelotero de los Bravos. Y me dijo, bien, yo te voy a echar 10 pesos de gasolina y me echó $10.
Only a Brave for 2 weeks, Pascual Perez thought he could follow the directions someone had given him to the stadium. He would show up 5 minutes after the national anthem. In his place, the oldest Brave would stand. That he won that night was almost secondary. The losing streak had this team one step short of an overdose. It needed a spark, a good laugh, and the plight of Pascual Perez would bring that, turning their growls to laughter, their seasonal round.
The thing about this, the game of baseball, is you play 162 games and you're going to have bad streaks. It's only how you rebound from bad streaks indicates what kind of club you are. And our bad streak was a little longer than we'd like to think about, but we're still rebounding, and which signifies that we have a good ball club.
We'll lose some ungodly amount of games, 21 out of 23 or whatever it was, and bounce back and still be tied for the lead. I mean, that shows a lot of class to me. We could have given up and died and rolled over and just washed up the season and said, you know, hey, we gave it a good shot, but that's it. But we didn't do that. We kept battling and scratching and clawing, won 5 games in a row by one run, and that shows me a lot of class.
Hoot, every game we win now, I don't give a what it costs us.
That cost would be too expensive for the other teams. All they could do was sit back and admire what was finally happening to this collection of men.
Just a fact of life, when you face any good team, usually the 3, 4, and 5 hitters are your best hitters. So they're not alone in being good hitters on that team. It's just one of the best offensive teams in the league.
We would like to gain some ground on them. But before we could catch Atlanta, we got to catch San Diego. They're the ones on top of us.
You know, the Braves are always going to have a good contending team. The Braves have always been a team that scored runs, even since the days I was there.
Is this another Dodger commercial, man?
And Horner and Murphy and Hubbard and Chambliss.
It's hard to really find a soft touch in the lineup. It seems like most ball clubs you can find somebody that you figure, well, I can get him out in a jam. But these guys, they really don't seem to have a soft touch. And in this ballpark, they're going to score a lot of runs.
They're the team to beat. I can't see anybody beating them in that game.
Oh, I think Atlanta's going to be tough all the way. I don't think they've got a weak spot on their team. And their pitching's been holding up very well. I think they right now they'd have to be the favorite.
You play Atlanta if you can jump out in front against them, and before they get to that bullpen, then you got a much better chance. And that's a big key with our ball club. We got to score early, because if we don't, we can't do our running game. That's enough, Jesus.
I just can't get myself to take out Murphy.
Of course not. Dale Murphy would lead the league in most of the important slugging categories. In his own quiet way, he would finally reach the potential everyone had predicted for 7 seasons. But not without prodding. Joe Torre knew that if this team was to accomplish its miracle, it would have to be led by Murphy. And so, Torre's managing seemed to focus almost relentlessly, but gently, on his giant outfielder.
Murph, I want you to come to my room tonight after the game. I want you to come to my room tonight after the game and put you on the water wheel.
Rack.
And just go.
One pitch. Change up, grounded to third. Save. The sacks for one, the relay.
Murph, you know, he just gives those times at bat up. You know, he gives them away. Gives the times at bat away.
And you don't see that very often. Dale Murphy has hit into two double plays so far in this contest. A 5-4-3 DP right there for the Dodgers. Their 91st double play.
There's no way that guy should get him out, you know, without a battle.
That easy.
With a battle.
1-1 pitch. Slow curveball tapped right back to Valenzuela. On to first base, and we have one down. 11 in a row now.
Looking for something and swung at something else. I'd like to take his head and put it between two cymbals. Just go like that. Come on, Murph.
Hop, back out of play.
Oh, yeah. Come on, Murph. Nothing to wait on, Murph. This is the one we're just going to have to bite at. Pitch to Murph.
Hit foul, straight underneath it.
Stay in there. Come on. Stay in there. Come on, let's go, Dale.
Now the 2-2. Got him on a curve. Murphy down on strike.
If he takes bad batting practice, he has a bad game. You got to get on him with a whip in batting practice. Come on, Murph. Hey, watch the ball now. Hey, Sonny.
Watch the ball, Murph.
No, he's swinging where he saw it last.
Duco with a 1-2 pitch. Fastball, swung on and missed, he struck him out.
Your bat is going underneath the ball.
Yeah, I know.
You know what I mean? Your bat's going underneath. Even though you're not coming out as bad, you're still you're doing right there. Instead of getting mad and saying, jam me, and fighting that ball off. Keep that front shoulder pointing at the pitcher.
But of course, there must be a soft spot somewhere for a man with this kind of ability.
Home run. Took his hat off. Pitcher took his hat off. Come on, Murph. They should get that ball for him, too. That's the most he's ever hit in a year. 34 homers.
Well hit to left. That ball is going, and it's out of here. Deep time. The pitch to Murph. Swung on. Drill. Deep center field. David, way back. Out of here.
The next time 1-1 pitch to Murphy. Fly ball. Deep right field. Vukovic going back. Looking up. This one is out of here.
Fly ball right, Clark back, still going back, this ball is out of here.
One strike pitch, fly ball right field, it's deep, looking up is Durham, and this ball is out of here, we get a tie game.
Home runs are not the only way Dale Murphy can make his manager smile.
Here's the stretch by Steve Howe, the 0-1 pitch, line drive, right center field, base hit, Washington around third, he is going to score, and the Braves are back in first place.
Dale Murphy would provide some big numbers. Not only would he become the team's most valuable player,
but also he'd be named MVP in the National League. And also big numbers would be posted by Joe Torre's pitching staff. There'd be no set rotation. A violent negative in a sea of positives. Pitching would be a problem all season long.
And the 2-1 Rick Mailer pitch. High. He's been consistently high. 3-1 the count.
3-1. 2-0. 3-1. Who'd go on out there and talk to him? Yeah. Get him mad or something.
And the strange part about it, Ted, is when they do pitch the way we teach them, they're successful.
Well, why? Then it's your... It's like if your children don't do what you told them to do.
We can only put them between the lines. We can't go out there and stand behind them.
Yeah, you can go out there. You can go out there once in any.
Once, and we do.
It always looks like you go out there when they're in trouble. Because that's the only time you need to go out there. They're doing all right. But you tell them, if you see them get... They get out of an inning every now and then doing it. When they come back into the dugout, between innings, you tell them to throw it across, throw strikes.
Talk to them in between innings, every inning, down in the dugout, down in the runway, everything you can imagine. And they go, mm-hmm. And they go back out there and they do it their way. And I don't know how you overcome that. All you can do is tell them.
I know you're all right, but you're throwing, not worth throwing, worth the... Standing out here guiding the ball, you're getting under the ball of Thomas, and you're just hoping, wishing it across the plate. Instead of getting through this game the same way you got into this eighth inning. Throw the... Come on.
Some of them, they have their doubts whether I'm right or not, and they keep getting their butt knocked off, and I tell them that's not what you do, and then they call it second guessing.
That ball is touched off into left center. Does it get out? Yes, sir. A two-run homer for Rupert Jones. After two little ground balls just barely went foul, he hit one out in the opposite direction.
Hey, you second-guess yourself. You second-guess yourself on a knuckleball you threw Rupert? You didn't do that. Anytime you throw a knuckleball, it's that fucking
just
arm.
Okay, I throw it just the way I threw the guy. Instead of really busting it, two of them in a row, I just tried to get over the plate, took a little bit off of it.
That's buy-in now.
Yeah.
You can't let that haunt you now. Okay?
Just throw the...
Mailer 16-13 in the major leagues. Against the Cardinals 1-1. Beat him back on May 16th. High chopper, could be trouble. Ramirez. Safe.
Threw three pitches in a row up. Four pitches, really, the one first one. Two, three pitches in a row.
Nobody out, runner first.
Another one.
304. Leads the league in stolen bases, drives it foul, down past first.
Gotta get the ball down.
Hey, Bruce!
Runner going, living a ride. Base hit. It'll be first and third.
He hadn't thrown a ball below the belt yet.
Yes, they're down in the league in home runs. They depend on singles and doubles. This guy can hit a ball out of the ballpark. He did Sunday.
Go ahead, Hoot. Get the f***ing ball down, damn it.
Here comes Bob Gibson out. He wants to talk it over. They're saying hoot, hoot for Bob Gibson. Gets a big hand here. Hall of Famer who pitched his entire career in front of these fans. Listen to the hand for Bob Gibson. Hernandez at 279.
Might just start daily.
There are your runners. Her at third and Smith at first. He's hit center. throw is late in the third, or is it? Yes, it is.
Get him ready in a hurry.
There's Ken Daly and Joe Pignatano alongside. Pomaroma's warming him up. Pignatano is one of the hard-working coaches this business.
He is ready. I'm going to get him if he puts him on. All right, here.
Ball four. Well, just like that, Rick Mailer pitches himself right out of this ball game because here comes Joe Torre. The second visit, that's an automatic. See you later. It's unfortunate for Rick, too, because he's got a 5-0 lead going in, and every pitcher, when he's given that lead, wants to take advantage of it. But Mailer faced four batters and retired no one. Three straight hits and a walk. And Ken Daly's on his way in.
What do you got, Joe?
Daly.
All right.
Yeah, man at all.
That was high.
Everything.
Ken Daly.
Nobody out, Kenny. You get the ball back to you and Bruce now. Okay?
Right.
Nobody out. Okay?
Right.
Good shot. Go.
Daly ready. And pitching.
Up the ladder, that's the way. Same thing.
Coming. Driven to left field, way back toward that wall. Out of here, home run.
In a chalked rectangle, 10 feet off the third base line, stands the coach. There is a hidden line of communication between him and the manager. Hand signals from the manager to the coach to the player. And even that sometimes isn't enough.
Come on, Rufy, get a good jump here. He did, too. He did.
All right, go ahead and hit. Oh, gave him the take. Wrong finger.
Signals or signs are nothing more than small talk without the sound. Small talk is something you'll hear a lot of in the dugout or on the field. Anything to pass the time.
Detroit was winning 4-1. It's down to 3-2 now. Come on, rubber dub hub. Got a base open.
Petticoat Junction.
Don't you talk Spanish?
Oh, I understand.
You talk baseball? One guy, come here. One guy. See that little blonde-haired guy? Works with TBS. Glasses, comes in the clubhouse. You've seen him.
Yeah.
In the clubhouse. It's a kleptomaniac.
And now the end is near, and so I face this final curtain.
You're not a blondehead kid. I have a feeling we've done this before. There I call, buddy. Eight. I said, you're that blonde-haired guy that comes around the dugout, I mean the clubhouse, the glasses, the TBS. Watch him, the kleptomaniac.
I've been talking. Kenny was standing over here, wasn't looking at me. I said, Kenny, never tell you about these three nymphomaniacs got caught in a barn? And he's sitting there like this, and he goes, go on, go on.
Bow-legged, man. If he straighten his legs up, he might be 6'5".
Get right in line of the pitch.
Cut your toes off, your shoes will be a lot smaller.
They must think that it's a football game on tonight.
Bless you.
All right.
It's all right. No, you're fine. That's fine. I'm looking at you, not the camera. Wow, hey, good looking.
That's all, folks.
The sure cure for passing time during a baseball game are the mascots. In Philadelphia, something called the Fanatic. That's P-H-A-N-A-T-I-C. In Montreal, it's Yuppie. And in San Diego, it's the Chicken. Chicken not only keeps the crowd in stitches, but has strange allegiances as well.
Let me tell you, you know my heart is in San Diego, but oh, I'm pulling for them Braves. Do it, Braves, do it. Woo! Don't like the Dodgers down here, you know what I mean? But we love them Braves. In Atlanta. Woo! Woo!
Yeah. Yeah, but we called time back in.
He called time out. On the pitch.
No, he called timeout.
He called timeout, Paul, really.
I'll ask him. What do you want me to ask him, Tommy? Did he call timeout? I think he put time back in.
He asked for time, and I acknowledged it when the guy was coming through, so I got to go.
That's right. You're right.
But if they'd hit a home run, it wouldn't have counted either. You're right, Tom.
How about the life of the umpires? Their work takes them from one coast to another for 6 months, stopping only long enough to have their heritage challenged by strangers.
Oh, this guy over here is a pain in the neck. He's been on my frame for 6 innings.
Look at him. You see the biggest mouth you've ever seen? Look at that.
Big mouth.
He's got a headache over there.
You're embarrassing your date.
Guys like him just make me laugh all night long. You know, it's just really rabid.
It's a different type of life. As far as it being a terrible life, it's not. I mean, I love it. I've got a lot of nice friends. I eat in the best hotels. Good restaurants, stay good places, meet good people. I like it. If I didn't like it, believe me, I wouldn't be doing it.
I enjoy umpiring. Probably the most difficult part of umpiring to me is being away from my family during the summer. I'm very fortunate to have a swell gal for a wife and two great kids, and I miss them terribly.
Harry Wendelstedt occasionally is able to soothe that need. When he's in Atlanta, he brings his family in from Florida for a few days. But what about the other umpires? Well, their home away from home families become the next closest person.
Carter's telling us something about something bouncing over something down there. What's different?
See when the guy's walking down the kid?
Yeah.
If bouncing ball bounces over where he's at, over the stands, we kill it. Two bases.
Bounces over the stands, over right. The people's head, and on into the bullpen area.
Dead ball.
They're kind of dead since there's people sitting there, right?
Right. And they might touch it.
Yeah.
More pressure on us to see if anybody touched it or not.
All right, I got it.
So if it bounces over the stands, we kill it. But a fly ball, you can go back and catch it. All right?
That's fair. I'm not sure I like it, but it's all right.
Oh, we got a spot on that one. I'll take it back. You saw it?
That spot's not any worse than that one right there.
No, that's just a little bit of dirt. Listen, you can't become a baseball analyzer. I mean, it takes years of experience. One's dirt, one's a cut.
Tell Royster to get back in the dugout. Tell Royster to get back in the dugout. It's going to cost him 100.
How are you feeling today?
I always feel good.
Huh?
I always feel good.
You always feel good?
Yes. Hey, Bill.
Hi, Bill.
Hi, Billy. How you doing?
Great.
You doing just fine, huh?
You'll never get me here, bud.
That's right.
Changed from yesterday?
Huh?
Any rules changed from yesterday?
No.
That's it, huh?
We can make a few, though.
Good luck to you both. Come out swinging.
Sit down and shut up! You're giving everybody a headache! Drink your beer!
Sometimes, however, they just as soon not have to talk with anybody.
Now the check of the runners and the 0-1 pitch. There's a good bunt out in front of the plate. Socia going to third. Throw it away! Here comes Camblis! Racing toward third is Horner. He's going to be waved. Some fans have now fallen on top of that ball. Some fans were leaning over the railing. The railing gave way, and the fans fell on top of that ball. And now it remains to be seen what will happen to the runner, Bob Horner. Will he be allowed to score, or will he be sent back to third? Third base umpire Paul Runge coming over, talking it over with plate umpire Bob Engel and second base umpire Terry Tata. Socia tried to pick up that ball and throw to third in one motion, threw it away, and when it got down toward that Dodger bullpen, some fans leaning over the railing had that railing cave in on them, and they fell right on top of the ball.
Well, you'll see the throw first, and many times we say the fans are your 10th player, but in this particular case, the fans weren't, because if the ball was let alone, the Braves would have been in good shape. But they touched it down there, and that automatically, it was touched before the fence broke. And this is going to cost the Braves probably at least 90 feet. They're talking it over right now. Fan interference, and they might not let Horner score.
And this is really an unusual thing to have happen in this particular game, because we've got a Toyota call-in question going on right now about should the umpires have instant replay available And I'm sure on a play like that, they wish they did, because they're not sure exactly where the runner was when the fans interfered. And actually, the fans interfering all came about because of that caving in of the rail out there. Although the ball had already bounced away. They were actually more interfering with the left fielder, Dusty Baker, than they were with anything else. And they're going to bring Bob Horner back to third.
He's scoring them anyway, whether he's there or not. Oh, that's...
Ball stops over there now.
Yeah, go ahead. Dusty wasn't right. You don't think he's going to go home? You don't think he's going to go home on that?
That's only with one thing.
Go ahead.
Ball stops with a fan. We don't get any cam or anything.
What kind of cam defenses are broke anyway? The ball...
Oh,
the throw, it's not a hit ball,
if
Bob.
If he was near third, I'd say
he
yeah.
He was right here. Son of a arm is going like that anyway.
He wasn't even in third.
What?
Oh, it's not.
That's just what the it is, you not. Son of a...
You're the same way.
You just
either
stop
the
way.
Way. I'm not
That's the worst display of... Sitting around and talking and coming up with another wrong answer.
That's the one we're going to go with.
Well,
now, you want to play with it? You want to go in
no,
the
that's your way out. Go ahead. That's horse.
And if the umpires wanted the manager or anything else to disappear, they might turn to fellow umpire Ed Montague.
One final trick. I want you to tell me when to stop. Stop. All right, look at your card. Don't tell me what it is. Show it to the camera.
Yeah,
show it. Take it out and show it. Okay. Now you put it back in the deck and shuffle it up. Or just keep the whole deck. What I want you to do is I want you to write your card on that piece of paper and fold up the paper. What I need is a lighter now. Where's that lighter? Now you can't find the lighter. Okay. What we're going to do is we're going to set this paper on fire and I'm going to show you what you might call black magic. This is called setting the umpire's dressing room on fire.
Or setting your asthmatic off.
Just about dwindles down. You haven't forgotten your card yet. Watch what happens when I take these ashes and crumble them up into my hand. Watch this close as we roll them on my arm and find out what the card you picked was a seven of diamonds. I don't know how that got. Seven of diamonds?
That's one. Oh, that was very good.
When you stop to think about it, a ball player spends over half a year eating, sleeping, being in the ballpark at work, and traveling. And of them all, traveling is the tough part. I know when I came up to the big leagues, all travel was by train. And sitting here in this railroad station, I think about the fact that used to travel by private Pullmans, special diners, sometimes even special trains, and it was pretty wonderful. Today, all travel with baseball spread from coast to coast is of necessity through the air. And you don't see much of the country because you'll be flying in the small hours of the morning after playing a night game.
Oh,
Traveling can be an introduction to new worlds. These two rookies, Ken Smith and Larry Wissington, have never been to Montreal before. They will explore a dozen more new worlds before this season is finished.
Yeah,
50,000 air miles from one coast to the other, a dozen cultures in between. San Diego, the Padres can wait. But just 30 miles south is another new world, Tijuana. Baseball might as well be 1,000 miles away. For an afternoon, Bob Walk, Tommy Boggs, Rick Camp, and John Holland star in their own 8mm film. At times, the wives travel with their husbands.
Let me
We could have had it, but it wouldn't be cleaned up at all. I said, no. New room, thank you.
Maybe one or two trips a year. Most times, though, they remain at home. On this particular team, however, eight wives spent at least half the season at home carrying the team's future. This baby shower was for Cheryl Mailer and Jill Daly. Players' life is a very private life, complicated by the fact that they've become public figures. Thus, they seek refuge in any number of ways. And when they gather together to honor each other, though mostly in jest, they run a banquet room in a hotel on the road, and only their own are admitted.
So we want to honor our coaches, not in any particular order. Coach Joe Pignatano. Piggy. Out of it. All right, all right.
Thanks, pal.
You're welcome. Coach Bob Gibson. Way to go, Gibby. All right.
Say a few four-letter words.
That's the way I did it.
This one's got a glare on it. This one's got a... Oh, Rube Walker. Anyway. Coach Sonny Jackson. There you go. Okay, we're going to hold on to Maxie's, and but I wanted to really honor Maxie for putting up with us for missing. I've never seen a team miss so many signs in all my life. We should have gave out a trophy for as the guy that missed the most signs, but we would have had to give out about 12 of those. This year's winner for the Gopher Ball Award is our judge, Phil Negril.
Thank you, Jerry. It was just a couple guys that's responsible for this, and that's definitely Bruce Benedict for putting the wrong signs down. I think you can understand that in Pocorobo when he's in there. But there's two guys. I've been playing baseball for 24 years. I've never had the honor to receive this before, but there's two guys made it possible for me to accept this award this year, and that's Bob Gibson and Rube Walker. And I thank you very much.
this is the Guillotine Award. And a lot of you guys deserve it, too. Including myself. But we've got some guys. Randy Johnson, please stand up. I'll tell you, you got guild. You didn't win this award, so you're getting guild again. But anybody that gets sit down right at deadline, I'll tell you, that's severe guild. As you see, the guy's head is chopped off, but it's laying right over here. The guillotine struck it. It's laying off to the side. But this year's winner goes to a guy that was sent up and down three times. Not you, Brett. You're getting guild again. You ain't getting this neither. Kenny Smith. Kenny, we were going to put a yo-yo on here since you were up and down so much, but we decided to just chop off your head and give you the guild. Give you one more time. All right. Well deserved. Attaboy, Smith. Yeah. The last trophy that we have here is for the most valuable player. And the nominations for this and the voting, like I said, once again, was really good. And it was close, especially in this one. Nominated was... But Phil Negro was first runner-up on this balloting. And Glenn Hubbard also received votes along with Gene Garber. I didn't get any. Matter of fact, I didn't get much of anything. But this year's winner, most valuable player, Dale Murphy. Thank you. Way to go, man.
Speech.
Thanks. I didn't know you even gave this award out, but I appreciate it. I don't feel that way by any means that most valuable player. I just don't feel that at all, but I appreciate it, and I think we got 25 most valuable players. Thanks, Jerry.
Every single one of these players dreams of ending up here. I was fortunate enough to make it with a microphone. The greatest Brave of them all made it with his bat.
They called him the Hammer. His 715th home run, which broke Babe Ruth's record, was voted by the media and baseball officials as the greatest moment in the history of baseball. Still reading the official language, listen to these records. Also set records for games played, 3,298, at bats, 12,364, long hits, 1,477, total bases, 6,856, runs batted in, 2,297. Top that. There's only one of these, Henry Aaron. Yeah!
I'll hold on this for you. Okay. And take your time and do whatever you want to do. It's your show.
It won't be long. Thank you very much, Commissioner Kuhn.
I feel a great sense of humility, gratitude, and appreciation for this day and for what it means to me and my family. I'm extremely proud to be joining a group of men who performed on the baseball field, epitomize the highest and the best in professional athletics. I'm pleased to be joining them in the company of Travis Jackson, Happy Chandler, and Frank Robertson, some of baseball's greats. I want to thank the ones I would like to thank Mr. John Mullen, who was introduced earlier, Mr. Bill Bartholomew, and also my boss, Mr. Ted Turner from the Atlanta Braves. Thank you for coming. All of you have touched my life in a very positive way. I am so very grateful to you and so pleased that you could share this evening with me. Thank you very much.
This is it. You can't go or you can't receive any higher honor than this. No matter whether you hit 800 home runs or hit 400 batting average, you know, this is the goal and this is the ultimate building where everybody wants to see their face enshrined in this building.
In Cooperstown, a plaque. Back home in Atlanta, a statue, appropriately larger than life. Watches over this team we're following. That simple child's game we've talked about so often has become a complicated, very orchestrated symphony composed by hundreds. Come inside with us and meet the other team at the ballpark. The one man most responsible for this baseball team is the traveling secretary.
Thanks. What a guy.
He is the man who gets you there and back.
I got my porch parked outside with my bags all packed. I didn't know whether I was supposed to bring the car in the parking lot here tonight or what. No, I'm just going to leave my Porsche here so when I get back off the road trip, I can just, it'll be here. Chris is bringing down the Cadillac. She's only going to New York, so she'll need the car when she flies back to here.
Bill Acree is in charge of the team, pure and simple. Baggage. Airline tickets.
Down to 59 total seats, okay. 12 passengers.
Boarding passes. Itineraries, buses, room keys, and perhaps the nastiest job of them all, optioning players from the majors to the minors.
That's it, they're gone.
This summer, he'll get used to it. There'll be 48 roster changes before it's all over.
Need to cancel Porter, They had Tommy Boggs. Also, Callie was going to be with Randy Johnson. Canceled Callie.
Whether they are sent to the minors or simply set free, the emotions of the expendable player remain the same. Some merely express them more eloquently than others. His name is Al Roboski. On the pitching mound, he is a seething, angry young man. But without a mound, well...
You come into this game, you know one thing is inevitable. Your playing career is going to end. Everybody thinks they can play longer than they physically can. I don't know if I've come to that point. Now I have to sit back and maybe, you know, and say next week at this time, if no other clubs want my services, or say next, if I can't get a job next spring, if I so, you know, choose to do so, then I probably would have to deal with that rejection. Ted gave me an opportunity to come here, and under the free agent rules and things like that, he made me an awful nice lifetime contract. And so naturally I wanted to reciprocate, and I wanted to be the best pitcher I could possibly be. And, you know, I failed him, but I failed myself first. I think the biggest thing that anybody, any successful person has to be is you have to be your own biggest critic. And I realized that, you know, I'm the one that failed. It wasn't the fact that Joe didn't pitch me enough or this or that, because the times when he did pitch me, if I would have done the job, I would have been back out there more frequently. Talking with Rube last night, Rube Walker, Rube, you know, just said flat out, he says, I don't think you can pitch anymore. And why embarrass yourself? And I respected that very much. I really wanted to hear that. I needed to hear that instead of, you know, just trying to garble it away or something like that. And I just told, you know, he said, why don't you go into something else? Do something else. You don't have to worry financially. And I said, I still think I can pitch. He said, I'll call anybody in baseball. And I said, well, I appreciate that, but if you call anybody, you tell them honestly that you feel I can't pitch. And he said, well, I'd have to do that. And I said, well, that's the only way I'd want it to be.
Even through rejection, Al Roboski's heart remained with the Atlanta Braves. And nothing was more important to him than seeing them win.
They deserve it. I've had my time in the sun, the glory, or, you know, whatever you want to say. And I think the biggest mistake that I could make right now is to start putting negative things in my mind, or put thoughts such as that, you know, what if? Hey, I want them to win, and I want them to enjoy that, and maybe, hopefully, you know, they'll remember, you know, that I was part of the team.
The last time the Braves left Candlestick Park in San Francisco, they left first place behind. Now they return. It is the season's final week, seeking to regain what they feel is rightfully theirs.
Uh-oh, there's a bad throw. 2-on-6 score. Washington races for third, and he'll make it. What a break. Lined into right center field. Davis on the run. He'll never get there. One is home. Ramirez rounds third. He's racing for the plate. There'll be no throw. It is 7-0 Atlanta.
With an eye always on the out-of-town scoreboard, the Braves would depend on the right arm of Phil Niekro.
Ball, no contact. Strikeout number three for Phil Niekro, and a 1-2-3 inning here in the fifth for San Francisco.
Final. Cincinnati beat up. Cincinnati beat the Dodgers 6-1. The Braves, if they can hold on, are tied for first, and they need one out, and Evans takes low. The windup and the 2-1. Bouncer second. The Braves are tied for first.
gave us a few runs there in the first few innings. I think that had a lot to do with it. I think maybe at a certain point, it was kind of getting me going a little bit, and then it brought the Dodgers score across the scoreboard, and of course they were losing there. And, I think the momentum was definitely in the dugout. It was with the ball players, and I think you could definitely feel it. We had the momentum going there.
The momentum would carry into the next night.
Now a 2-2. Line to right base hit. Murphy just protected the plate. He didn't have that big swing. He reached out and slapped it in the right field. It's 1-0 Atlanta. The pitch. Harper lines it over third. Is it fair or foul? It is fair. Right on the line. One in, two in. Here comes Murphy. And three runs are going to score. 3-1. Well hit. Base hit. Harper's going to score. Royster at first will hold on there.
The bullpen and the defense had carried them this far and a bit further.
Runner going, broken bat, tap up the middle. Did he tag him? I think so. Throw to first, he is out. They got the double play and have 180 on the year, and what a play by Ramirez.
For the second straight night, Joe Torre and his Braves would gather their smiles from near and far.
Take a look at the bottom two lines. The Dodgers had the bases loaded in the 10th inning with nobody out and failed to score in their 4-3 loss to the Reds. Now the 1-1 on the way from Perez. Fly ball, left field, toward the line. Harper makes the running catch, and the Braves are back in first.
Most winning clubs are loose, and this team has been loose all year long, despite what the press has really tried to lay on us. So we're a very happy group. Guys who are loose, they have a lot of fun, and that's really how you win, is to have fun in baseball. You can't be tight and play this game.
Los Angeles. The Braves come in winning 4 of their last 5. The Dodgers had lost 7 straight. Still, the usual Dodger Stadium sellout. Everybody knew the importance of this one.
I think this is probably the most important game we're going to have in 1982.
It's a big game, I think. You know, definitely so far the biggest game this year.
If we win tonight, it puts the Dodgers in a real bad light because we have beat their best.
But the best on this night would be the Braves' rookie left fielder, Terry Harper.
Well hit left field. Back goes Baker. An 0-2 pitch, and Harper's tied the game with his first home run of the year. Welcome west, Terrence.
Now an 0-2. Loop towards center field. Will it be in? It's going to be in for a base hit. The Braves are going to lead here.
Races aren't won in August, they're won in September, and that's where we are now, and we're winning, and everybody else has got to catch us.
We're 2 games up with 4 to go. Can't say anymore now, we're in a good position. It's in our hands now. Can't be go out tomorrow, beating tomorrow. It's our division.
Just can't wait until we're up 3 with 2 to play. Then I'll say, okay. Right now, I'll be happy to lose Sunday's game as the only other loss we'll have this year.
The next night, the Braves came out to take another early lead.
Braves 2 games up. Well hit. Past third. Raffy's at second. We'll watch him. He's at third. They're going to wave it. Here he comes. The throw will be late. And Murphy's got a double and an RBI. And the Braves are on the board.
But the Dodger Murphy fans would finally have something to dance about. But this would be their last hurrah.
Comes the 0-2 pitch. Line drive, left field, base hit. Sack scores. Landreau around third. He'll score as Harper overruns the ball and left. Dusty Baker winds up at second. It's 8-3.
pitch to Washington, hit toward third, caught in the air by Say, and the ball game's over. Our final score, Dodgers 10, Braves 3.
San Diego. The Braves' lead is a single game with three remaining. Again, their elder statesman gets the call. You think Phil Niekro didn't want this one? Why, he even turned slugger for a night.
The 1-0 pitch, fly ball, deep left field. Back goes Richards. This one is out of here. Phil Niekro has hit the first home run in 6 years, and the Braves have taken a 3-0 lead.
That have been around the major leagues and won a lot of games for a lot of years. They can really smell that victory when they get to this point in the ball game. Here's the 2-1 pitch, fly ball, well hit right center field. Washington makes the running catch, the ball game's over. And Phil Niekro has recorded his second consecutive shutout. And his own home run was the big, big blow in this game.
I've been waiting for this day and the weeks ahead for a long time, and I was definitely going to try and take advantage of it if I could, and I got a pitch to hit. I don't even know what it was. I was just up there whacking at it as hard as I could just in case I hit it, and I hit a good part of the bat and it carried the seats.
The thing to keep in mind now is we got two more ball games to play, and we still need some help to win the championship tomorrow night, and it's something that we need to think about. And you'll find in these type of situations, I think, championship seasons, you get these types of performances from people like Phil Niekro.
Another veteran would supply the winning punch the following night.
Now the one-strike delivery. Fly ball, deep right field. Tony Gwynn going back on the warning track. This one is out of here. A long home run for Chris Chambliss. And Chris set a goal for himself at the beginning of this season. He said he's never hit 20 home runs in 1 year in his entire career. And he would like to accomplish that this season. He just has. His 20th home run, his 86th RBI, and it's now 3-0 Atlanta.
Garber with his first pitch.
Let up, bounce, up to second, Hubbard, Braves win, and here come the Braves. Braves win, and here come the Braves. They've got themselves right now a tie for the pennant.
It has come down to this, a one-game lead, one to play. It has been a week of musts, a week of pressure.
Man. Drive to right field. Back goes Monday. It's gone.
Joe Morgan has just hit a three-run homer for the San Francisco Giants. They lead the Los Angeles Dodgers 5-2, still batting in the bottom half of the seventh. The Braves perhaps just one out away from losing this ball game, but don't give up yet, because the Giants have taken a three-run lead over the Dodgers. Here's the 1-2 pitch. Popped him up. Foul territory. Catcher Terry Kennedy will make the catch in the San Diego Padres.
A 5-1 loss to the Padres would keep the champagne on ice for now. This team would have to wait to learn its fate. It would rest in the hands and bats of the Dodgers and Giants, still playing some 500 miles up the same Pacific coastline. If the Dodgers lose, the division championship would belong to Atlanta. The Braves gather 6 months after it all began to watch and wait. Here's Dodger announcer Vin Scully to tell you about it.
The ninth inning at Candlestick Park, three outs away between the end of the regular season or a date Monday with Atlanta. And the Dodgers find themselves down by two. Ron Say hit a two-run home run in the second inning. It was his sixth home run of the year against the Giants. He struck out in the fourth, and he singled a right in the seventh. Now just trying to get aboard any way he can and keep it alive. Ground ball, back a third. What a stop by Evans. His throw got it. Play. Evans taking a short double away from Ron Say, and the Dodgers expending one of the three precious outs. And the batter is Ron Renicki hitting for Bill Russell, for Steve Yeager. And the chant again. You can probably hear it in Los Angeles without a sound system. Beat LA, beat LA. Going to live on that all winter up here. Renicki hitting .307 as a left-handed batter, and he was the most productive Dodger pinch hitter with 13 hits and 5 RBI. Foul back, and each strike now will elicit a louder noise from the crowd. 1-2. On the corner. Say one thing, it would have been a lot less painful had Atlanta just won in San Diego. Now, of course, this crowd on its feet, enjoying the writhing last moments of a Dodger ball club one step from the end of the year. Russell with Guerrero on deck. Right. Boy, you'd think the Giants were heading to the playoffs, wouldn't you?
beautiful feeling, of course. I mean, I don't think I ever felt better in my life. I'm just proud of everybody, you know. That champagne's cold, too, I can tell you that.
It's no time for the week. It's no time for anybody with an ulcer or bad nerves. I just wait until the last game, last hour. Hold on to big
game. I feel super. This is great. This is what it's all about. This is the reason that you play the whole season. It's for the playoffs. And, you know, we're just going to go into it the best we can.
I like to say, you know, I want to be in this World Series and, you know, win the, you know, the World Series. All right.
You know, I'm just elated over the whole situation. Sweet stuff. You know, everybody counted us out early in the season, you know. We lost 19 out of 21, and they said the Braves couldn't do it. And we just displayed the character that we have on this ball club, and we bounced back from adversity time and time again. Today, we needed a little help from San Francisco, and we got it. And I thank Joe Morgan, and I'm going to send him a telegram for that three-run homer here today.
Get you, Gino.
Listen
on radio. No, I said, Gino, get up and throw it. When they started the ninth inning, I wanted Garber up in case Minton got in trouble.
Anything you would like to say to Joe Morgan right now, Joe?
I love you, Joe. I love you, Frank, for resting Joe yesterday. It was super. And Greg Minton, just keep the ball down until you face us next year. I thought it was great.
Joe, a lot of guys have faced adversity this year.
How about you?
Joe, a lot of guys face adversity, including yourself, from the Mets. We said Joe Torre never had a winning season. Anything you like to say to that?
Well, tomorrow's my first anniversary of getting fired, so I'm going to celebrate, that's for sure. It's I've never had a greater moment in my life, and hopefully it'll only become greater when we win the playoffs and the World Series.
Joe, you had such an intense face in there watching the Dodger Giant game. Can you share some of your feelings?
Oh, that's cold!
Oh, my God!
Yeah!
Woo! All right!
Woo! My feelings. I'll tell you, I had the same feelings. I felt I was managing the ball club. Not that I had anything to do with it. I just felt I was managing. My stomach would hurt unless we got the out. I didn't care. Even if they got strike one, I wanted strike three. We got two out, nobody on. I said, I hope somebody can get Bill Russell out, because we can't get Bill Russell out. And to see that ball hit to Evans, and then Evans make the throw across, I never did see Bergman catch the ball because everybody was jumping up and down. And then I was just looking for people to hug, and Piggy found me and about took my neck off.
You mean to me, and I guess it's just the woman in me.
It's a Long Way to October has been brought to you by Cable News Network, America's most important network, and by CNN Headline News, America's headline service. Now you have a choice in 24-hour television news from Turner Broadcasting System. If you don't have CNN and CNN Headline News, contact your cable operator today.